south of the border, down Mexico way. That's where I fell in love when the stars above came up to play. And now as I wander.
Hello there, all you expat wannabes. I'm Johnny Mueller, and you're listening to The Expat Files, Living in Latin America, the show that tells you just what it's like to live, work, play, and or retire down here in Latin America. It's a mix of the good, the bad, the ugly, and the great, and it's all right here, so let's get started.
All right, let's talk about some very weird expat experiences. You know, they happen all the time, so I guess you can't call them too weird then if they're frequently occurring. Let's just call them then out of the ordinary expat experiences. Anyway, I'm in this taxi the other day in Panama, and I was talking with the guy in Spanish, of course, about internet connectivity and cell phones in Panama, and this guy was talkative, so I got a lot out of him. I asked the guy about gringos who are just coming down for a short while and what they could do to buy a plan or some kind of pay-as-you-go internet service for the computer and maybe, you know, hooking up Wi-Fi for your telephone, whatever. Because these days, you know, you don't need roaming so much like you did before. That is, roaming when you're bringing your phone to other countries. So with all the competition and choices, what's the best options for gringos and expats down for a short term? Let's say a week, a month, a couple of months, or even longer. Although, funny enough, and what a coincidence, I was in the Panama airport, Tucumán, and I saw a big sign there. It said Claro, which is really the biggest phone company in all Latin America, and it serves the U.S. and Canada, too. I think it's something like 26 countries. Oh, and do I like the company Claro? Well, I certainly don't like the owner. He's kind of a despicable guy. You may have heard of him, and I've mentioned him before. Carlos Fatboy Sim. Or some say Carlos Fatboy Slim, which is just the opposite of an aptonym. Because he's a bulbous bowling pin looking guy. You know what an aptonym is, right? That's when your given name, your apellido in Spanish, that's your last name, is coincidentally similar or aptly suited to your profession or your look or your demeanor, whatever. For example, if your surgeon's name is Dr. Cutter, that's an aptonym. Or if you're a short, fat, ugly, billionaire megalomaniac like Carlos Slim, or Sim, whatever you like to call him, that's an aptonym. Oh, and why am I coming down so hard on this guy? Well, he's kind of the George Soros of Latin America. That should conjure up an image for you. Funny enough, everyone in Latin America knows something about this guy. They know who he is because he's got such power. But I haven't met a single person who likes him, who thinks they can trust him, who'd invite him to their daughter's quinceañeros party. Well, maybe if he paid for it. I think that says it all. Anyway, the phone companies here in Latin America are getting so competitive. You see signs and ads and competition everywhere, which is great. And it seems all the internet services work well enough. You get the speed and the download maximums as promised, because they are, after all, using first world equipment. But this is Latin America, so there's one other thing you can always count on. Crappy or intermittent customer service. That's a given, and I guarantee there'll be times you get really pissed off and you want to blow your stack, but I just recommend take a few deep breaths. And plan on the fact that whenever they screw up your bill or your service, whatever, you're going to lose a morning or afternoon hashing it out in their local business office. But I digress. Where were we? Oh, yeah. I'm in the airport, and there's this big sign that says, Claro now has free roaming in all 20-something countries that it's in. It includes most all of Latin America, Canada, the U.S., and most of the Caribbean islands, too. Which is, you know, a gigantic selling point if you travel a lot. Internationally, that is, which most people don't do, especially Latinos. And when they do, and when they have done, they always look for a Wi-Fi signal so they can get onto WhatsApp. Talked a lot about that in the previous show. You know, because it's internet-based chat, voice, audio, whatever you want it to be. So you don't even have to have a phone service or a data plan, just a somewhat smartphone. So anyway, just keep that in mind. If you come to Latin America, you buy a Claro chip for $3 and get like 100 minutes of free phone time, and you get free roaming in 20-something countries. Whereas most people coming down from the States with their phone will sign up for roaming and pay extra for that. You guys and gals traveling south from up in the States know that drill. It's usually a daily fee for roaming. But where were we? Oh, yeah. Talking to the taxi driver about what would be the best internet data plan service, whatever, if you were coming down to Panama or practically any country in Latin America. And, you know, taxi drivers are the perfect people to ask those kind of questions because they're on a tight budget. And, of course, they're always using Waze, Google Maps, and the Uber guys, the Uber app. So it's only natural. They'll use the most cost-effective and well-connected and stable internet plan that's available. So when I brought that up to the guy, he smiled and he said, "Look at this." And he pointed down to the console, you know, between the two bucket seats. And he showed me a little cigarette pack size modem. Actually, it was much thinner than a cigarette pack, but square like that. He had it charging. He said it had a battery and it could go without a charge for something like 5 or 6 hours. And he said he no longer had phone service at all. He was doing everything through Waze and WhatsApp using just a data plan and that modem. In his case, he was using a Movistar modem. Though he said all the cell phone and internet service provider companies in Panama will sell you their version of that modem. I think there's 4 companies. And he said, as usual, you could sign up with an 18-month contract, but you need credit references and bank accounts and stuff. Or you can pay as you go or pay ahead, called a prepaid service where there's no contract. Now, this guy didn't have a contract. He was pay as you go, meaning he had to buy the little apparatus, which is around $40. Then it's yours. You own it. However, if you buy a contract plan, he says, they give it to you for nothing. You just pay monthly at one of the little kiosks, or they'll deduct it directly from your bank account. But you see, a contract's for 18 months. Now, this guy was paying around $20 a month to have Wi-Fi everywhere. He just carried that little modem around with him everywhere he went. And he recharged it through his USB adapter connected to his cigarette lighter in his car. So if you ran into that guy in a supermarket, hardware store at the beach, he'd have that little thing very nearby, usually in his front pocket next to the family jewel. Nope, not a very good idea, since that kind of cell phone radiation is known to cause inflammation of the male epididymis cells. In other words, it could screw up your reproductive process, which might be a good thing here in Latin America. since the sperm count with North Americans is way down historically, with Latin American males still shooting 357 magnums, so to speak, could be that cell phone or modem in the pocket technique is the great equalizer. That un-PC enough for you? By the way, here in Latin America, most women carry their cell phones in their back pockets or in the bra. Also not a very good idea at all. So anyway, I said to this guy, "Is that the latest, greatest modem? Are you taxi drivers all using it now?" "Hell," he says, "you get complete Wi-Fi internet service, and if you have a computer, you can connect that too." And I'm thinking, wow, an unlimited data plan for something like $20 a month? So bringing that idea full circle, that's what you ought to do if you go to Panama, Honduras, any Caribbean island, Costa Rica, whatever. Go down to one of the cell phone companies and buy yourself one of those little modems. And guess what? You don't have to be a resident. You just show them your passport. Photoshop, maybe. I'm not recommending that. Just telling you what a lot of astute expats do to stay off the radar. And now you got internet everywhere. You don't have to worry about being in some Wi-Fi hotspot. You are the Wi-Fi. But do try to keep the damn thing away from your huevos. Oh, and the speeds? Well, they've got 2, 5, and 10 megabytes. And now with those free roaming plans, you can go from country to country and use the same device. At least that's what the promo pamphlets and signs and ads are saying, though I haven't tried that yet myself. Meanwhile, back in the taxi conversing with the driver, I found out a few more things. I said to him, "I just can't believe how the internet and telephone services have changed, for the better, of course, over just the past few years." He said, "Man, you can say that again," in Spanish, of course. Then he admitted, almost with a little shame in his voice, he said, "You know, it's embarrassing to say, but I was one of those idiots that took to the street, painted signs, got involved in roadblocks, and picketed government buildings when the government announced it was going to sell off certain cell phone bandwidths and the national phone company." He said, "We were all shocked by that announcement, thinking, as usual, only the politicians were going to benefit from that. So people protested everywhere," he said, "me included. And looking back, it was a dumb thing to do." "Do you know," he said, "just a few years ago, when the government owned pretty much the only cell phone company that existed in Panama at the time, we thought going down and signing up to get a cell phone that would take 2 or even 3 months to get was a huge improvement over a year or two to get a landline some years before that. And he said when we found out the government was going to sell off a piece of it to Claro, Tigo, Movistar, and some of the others, we took to the streets, set up roadblocks, and shut down some of the roads for a couple of days. Because the government unions and activists were telling us that once private companies come in, prices would rise for telephones and they'd lay off thousands of government telephone workers. Scared the hell out of us, really, he said. The union guys and activists were saying that the government has no business selling off our national patrimony. Here we all thought that since the government owned the phone company for 100 years or so, they had no right to sell it off to a private party. But what did we know? Then he shook his head again and said, boy, were we uninformed, even stupid. Just the opposite happened. He said now that the big international companies came in and bought some of the telephone spectrum, etc., you walk into one of their offices and you've got the phone, it's all programmed, you're online in less than an hour. And in the end, he said, our telephone and utility workers didn't lose their jobs. They just got shuffled around into different parts of the industry. Not to mention, he said, the 3 or 4 phone companies down here have a kiosk on practically every corner. And that stuff didn't even exist before. Those are all brand new jobs. And then you've got on every couple of street corners a phone repair shop. So here I was, stuck in a taxi, talking to a pretty intelligent taxi driver. He was a thoughtful guy who figured out for himself just why socialism does not work. In his own country, he got a little taste of both ends of it. Yeah, Venezuela and Cuba came up in the conversation. We were in the huge traffic jam, by the way, so we had a lot of time to talk. Yeah, as it turns out, I'd say about a half to a third of all Latinos and Latinas here in Latin America have a friend, relative, acquaintance, whatever, who came from Cuba or Venezuela. You know, Venezuelans are flooding into all the Latin American neighboring countries. And isn't it funny, when you talk to someone who actually knows someone from Cuba or Venezuela, they hate or at least distrust socialism and government big brother control. But the other half of Latinos and Latinas who have no friends and relatives from Venezuela or Cuba, they're the ones that are willing to give it a try because the theme is take from the rich and give to the poor. Free stuff for everyone and all that. You know, it's always been easy to pit the haves against the have-nots. And one of the oddest things is that for such a Christian culture, nobody seems to read their Bible. Where Jesus said, and you can look it up, the poor will always be with us. Hey, I'm no Bible thumper, but I went to Catholic school and I do remember that. Though on the flip side, it seems like most Latinos and Latinas who have some initiative and creative energy, they want nothing to do with socialism. Like, for example, that taxi driver, he owned his own taxi. In that regard, he told me only probably 1 in 50 taxi drivers in Panama City own their own cab. The rest, he said, rent their taxis daily, weekly, or monthly from one of the big companies that owns a fleet of cars. And the drivers, they pay anywhere from 10 to 15 bucks a day for the privilege of driving a cab. Turns out that's traditionally how the taxi business has gone down in Latin America. Most guys just rent those things. And their only other expense is gas money. And now that Uber and all the other ride-sharing services have arrived here in Latin America, man, that's yet another wrench thrown into the works. Oh, and it's the same thing with Airbnb. That's a wrench into the works of the traditional hotel tourism scenario, too. All right, speaking of government, protests, Big Brother, I'd like to say a word or two about the longest-standing government shutdown in U.S. history. Well, first of all, I'm with the founding fathers on the notion that a government that governs best governs least, and that's certainly an anathema to the way the government runs today. And our brilliant founding fathers said the government should have very limited powers, including to keep the peace, protect the borders, and provide stable and sound money for commerce. In other words, have a stable monetary system and a fair judicial system to settle disputes, etc. Oh, for the good old days, huh? As far as this government shutdown business, I've been seeing the phrase over and over again in the media. Quote, the government has been forced to discontinue all non-essential services. Have you looked up the definition of non-essential lately? That means services that are not necessary. You get it? Non-essential equals not necessary. Now, who doesn't understand that? So why would the U.S. government, a bankrupt government, with over $20 trillion in debt, be involved with giving out non-essential services. Obviously, if they're not necessary, get rid of them. That's why, in most cases, I personally have no sympathy for people who work for government. Sure, I know, if you're working for government and the checks aren't coming in because of the shutdown, that's a terrible thing for you and your family, but I'd say 95% of all the people in services in government are just basically make-work jobs that clog up and burden the lives of the rest of the working public. Meaning, people that produce goods and services that others actually want to buy. But again, I digress as usual. Sorry about that. You know, occasionally I get into a discussion with a do-gooder or a person who's getting a U.S. government pension. You know, there are hundreds of thousands of expats living down here collecting a pension because they were U.S. government school teachers. They make up a huge chunk of the retired population, mostly on the gringo tourist trail. You run into them all the time. And most of them, when they started teaching many years ago, they loved it. And soon enough, learned to hate it or hate the system, and they just hung in there to wait out their retirement. That's what I don't get. They hate the system or what it's turned into. But they're still mostly liberal Democrats. I don't get that. As for me, I'm an equal opportunity government hater, Democrat or Republican. But I'll tell you, these teachers who've moved down here to Latin America, they still think that if you vote the right person in up in the States, all will be saved. The right Democrat person. Now, I'll tell you, good old expat Eddie hasn't surfaced for a while, but I'll never forget the story he once told me about a friend of his in Texas whose dad worked at an armaments factory. And for some reason, an old senator in the state died who was responsible for getting all those defense contracts. And the factory got moved to another state when the congressman there had more pull and power. Well, the factory moved, some 600 people got laid off, including Eddie's buddy's dad. Then, for a while, the family was depressed and despondent. But eventually, the father got a new job, making $12 an hour instead of $20, and mom had to go back to work. They got over it, but it hurt. Though they always talked about the good old days when dad worked at the armaments factory. Get this, they were making hand grenades, landmines, detonator fuses. And Eddie said, you know, there was a complete disconnect in that family for what daddy was really doing every day. Going to work, putting together hand grenades, landmines, and fuses with great pride. So that, as George Carlin would say, short brown people in another part of the world could get their legs, hands, and guts blown up. And Eddie said there was something tragically wrong about the fact that the family never balked about the way daddy earned his money. Which is why I always say, I don't know if there's a God, but I'm certain there is a devil. Now, I know what you're thinking. Johnny's gone off his rocker. What's that got to do with teachers in Latin America? Well, I was talking to a couple of them who've started an investment club here in Latin America. Expat teachers, that is. And they, along with their teachers' pension plans, have a lot of their dough invested in the armaments industry. Oh, the irony, huh? Which brings us back to the subject of airports. We were talking about airports, weren't we? Anyway, we're all aware they have some very strange TSA rules these days, but do you know the rule for lithium batteries? I mean, everything's got lithium batteries in it these days. Computers, cell phones, flashlights, Xboxes, electric toothbrushes, blackhead removers. Yep, rechargeable, portable, blackhead sucking machines. Just saw one the other day. In fact, I was sitting next to a lady on the airplane who was grossing me out with one of those things, or should I say, one of those suckers. And you frequent travelers out there know that once you're on a plane, especially if it's full and you're stuck sitting next to someone like that, along with all the other stressors that go along with flying, man, it will not be a good day. Of course, as for me, I'd much rather be next to someone sucking out their blackheads than someone with intolerable bad breath and or BO. To me, that's tantamount to a criminal offense. I mean, come on, whatever happened to airplane etiquette? And I really think, along with the first class section on a plane, they ought to have a halitosis and generally disgusting person section on each plane. You know, a place to put whiny kids and people so fat the armrests disappear when they sit down. Then there's that guy. It's always a guy. Forever blowing his nose, hacking all the time, spitting up phlegm. Man, that's disgusting. And of course, we'll save a few spots for everyone who's got three or more face piercings. Anyway, that's what I'd do if I owned an airline. But back to bringing items with lithium batteries on airplanes. Here's the new rule on flights. If you check any airline's hazardous material webpage, all your lithium batteries and apparatus with lithium batteries have to travel with you in your carry-on luggage. Now, that's a bit counterintuitive. You think, well, if batteries are dangerous, because that's what it says on their websites, wouldn't you want them isolated in the cargo hold in case they explode or leak? Well, as it turns out, a very few lithium batteries actually froze in a cargo hold, expanded, and leaked. And now we've got these grand new rules we all have to follow. I mean, look, who hasn't left a couple of AA batteries or their electric toothbrush in their checked luggage? That's all rechargeable lithium battery stuff, but it's against airline rules and regs to do that. So then you might ask, if you're a frequent flyer, or let's say you have a vacation home in Cancun, wouldn't you like to fly down with some power drills or saws if you feel like doing a little handiwork around the beach house? Well, these days, almost all decent power equipment, drills, jigsaws, whatever, even chainsaws, believe it or not, are powered by lithium batteries, and you really have to watch out how you ship that stuff, for they'll take it away from you at TSA and you'll never get it back. Oh, and get this, a very cool guy who came down to my recent Expat Insider seminar told me he has a friend who is selling Swiss Army knives for, I think he said, $1 a piece. He bought them, he said, from a guy who worked at TSA who had a little bag full of hundreds of little confiscated Swiss knives. And you wonder where that stuff ends up. Well, wonder no more. Now, imagine how many $150 Bosch power drills have been confiscated that way. Well, you don't want that to happen to you, and it will, unless you adhere to the following rules quite closely. All right, suppose you've got a nice power drill with an extra battery inside its original case. To get it through, here's what you have to do. You have to take the drill and the drill bits and accessories and stow them in the checked-in luggage. But first, you have to remove the batteries. Then you wrap the battery's contacts with masking tape, packing tape, or duct tape. In other words, the contacts cannot be exposed. However, that's kind of stupid, because if you know anything about battery-operated construction equipment, you know the contacts are never exposed. The batteries are made with quick disconnects so they can be moved back and forth to the charger. So when you pull the battery off, the contacts are always hidden below a spring-loaded plastic trap door, so you can't see them. But you gotta wrap the battery anyway. That's what airline hazardous material websites say, according to TSA rules. Then, you got to put each battery into its own hermetically sealed plastic see-through Ziploc-type bag. And that goes with your carry-on luggage into the cabin of the plane with you. By the way, if you have a decent power drill, you know the detachable battery is about as big as a small jar of peanut butter. And airline and TSA regs say you can't have any more than two of those batteries with you in your carry-on luggage. Oh, and as far as AA and AAA rechargeable batteries, for your toothbrush, shaver, vibrator, nose hair, rotor-rooter, whatever, well, according to airline regs again, you can only have the batteries that are in the unit and two extra ones in your carry-on luggage. Again, that makes no sense, because if you look at those batteries for drills and they allow two of them, well, just compare them to the size of a AA or AAA battery, and man, it's like talking elephants and oranges. But no matter. That kind of craziness is to be expected when the government steps in and with a heavy hand starts regulating things. Oh, even more importantly, your batteries cannot be rated at more than 160 watts. So what does that mean? Well, if you look at any lithium-ion battery, it'll have an amp rating and a voltage rating on it. Almost never a wattage rating. So you'll have to remember your third grade math. Let me give you a typical example. Suppose you got a power drill rated at 3 amps and 18 volts. It'll say right on it. It's pretty typical. You might remember from 8th grade science, there's a thing called Ohm's Law. Wattage, which the maximum, like I said, is 160 watts, is equal to voltage times amperage. So you just multiply your two battery numbers together. 18 volts times 3 amps. That's 54 watts, about a third of the maximum 160 watt limit. Now, the only time you're going to ever approach that limit is if you have a really big power tool, like, for example, a sawzall, a chainsaw, or a very big hammer drill. But as for battery-operated tools the average consumer uses, you'll almost never have a problem. Except for the obvious problem that the government has imposed all kinds of stupid-ass rules and regs. Oh, and here's another thing related to that. If you use one of those freight forwarding services, I've spoken about those in detail many times before, you know, where you have a Miami box, it's sent to Miami, then it's shipped to whatever Latin country you're in, then you get charged by the freight forwarding company for the weight in pounds. Well, these lithium battery regulations have affected them recently too, because they're shipping all that stuff like Amazon products by air. In fact, just recently I bought one of those heavy-duty flashlights that's got a taser built into it, you know, kind of hidden. And when Amazon sent it to the Miami box to be freight forwarded to Central America, I got a note from my freight forwarder saying it'll be a week late. All right, a week, that's okay, no problem. And when I went down to pick it up, I thought, uh-oh, they know it's a taser and they're not going to let it through. But that wasn't the case at all. The lady at the desk said anything that's got a rechargeable lithium battery in it is routed to a special cargo plane that takes off only once a week. And that plane is loaded up with computers and everything that takes batteries, and it's pressurized like a normal cabin. They don't, as per TSA requirements, allow lithium batteries to be flown in a non-pressurized space. All because of those two or three batteries out of millions or perhaps billions that expanded and leaked in a non-pressurized cargo hold. As a result, we now have the TSA battery police. By the way, as for the TSA accumulating thousands of Swiss Army knives and who knows how many expensive power drills, not to mention all the odd stuff like bungee cords they take away when you're getting felt up during the pat-down, wouldn't you like to know whose garage, basement, or attic all that stuff ends up in? Talk about hidden perks of the job. What a racket. That said, before we sign off today, I'd like to mention that I've been getting a slew of emails about healthcare and healthcare insurance here in Latin America. So, I think next show I'll fill you in with some stuff on that subject I'm sure you've never heard before. Meanwhile, if you want to bone up on what's happening with Latin American healthcare and how to get first world medical and dental treatment at third world prices, be sure to go to www.theexpatfiles.com/healthcare to pick up my very own 100-page Latin American healthcare report. And on the next show, we'll go into a little more detail and answer some questions about healthcare people have been shooting me emails about. You've been listening to the Expat Files, Living in Latin America. If you need some help with your own Plan B, you can schedule a one-on-one phone call with me. But first, download my free Plan B questionnaire at www.thenewexpat.com. Better yet, if you want to get your Plan B going from right up there in the States, just sign up for my 9-hour Expat Essentials course. Get the perfect Plan B blueprint by going to theexpatfiles.com/academy. Nos vemos!